All right, so let's go over the TMF reference model. So this is the filing structure that most companies use. This is from the DIA reference model. This is version 3.2. They constantly make new versions, but they're very like slight tweaks. But this is what it's a free available like filing structure that a group called the DIA have put together. And they're like leading industry experts that said, hey, let's all make this standardized, right? And it'll just be easier for all of us. You don't have to follow this. So most companies will follow something very similar to this, but they might have their own tweaks. So that's just something to know that when you get hired and you get started, you might be like, this is different, you know, but there would be some very slight differences. It's good to really know this document. And like, I know, Max mentioned he's going to print this. That's really useful because if you can really know it, it helps you speed up your job so much. Also, if you just even know the zones and get an idea of, okay, like one is trial management. So that's like oversight. These are items that are going to be higher level, like planning items. So you have the TMF master file plan. And then you have like the list of SOPs used during the SOP. During this clinical trial. So you're looking at kind of what I think of as like what items are like the sponsors, right? The company that's making the medicine, recruitment plan, communication plan, monitoring plan. Now what's unique about our version is if you scroll to the side over here, this column O, this is new. This is something that we've added to the DIA. So that doesn't actually exist if you download their live version. These are all of our links, and they're documents that we've collected from other people or whatnot, or examples that we've tried to put together for things that we've collected over the years. And we've tried to redact things as we can. We try to put notes onto like what the document is and what you see. You don't always have to have this. So if you're going through and doing the practice project, you don't have to cite it if it's missing something. Like here it says a CRO logo and name. But just go through each of these items to be really familiar with the documents. So it's a monitoring plan. And then as an idea, this is basically a document that comes together to put together all of what we think is going to happen for the monitoring for the study, right? So that's what people that go out there and visit the CRAs, they make monitoring reports, and then they, you know, put together, and so the CRAs are gonna follow this as like their SOP, basically. What should they do? And so you can scan through this and see what it is, but this is just an example, right? But this gives you an idea of what it should look like. Give me one moment. And if we go back, we can check on some other ones. So these are mainly a lot of plans and documents from the sponsor on like how we should run the study. And that is in your zone one. So if you can kind of memorize all the zones and get an idea of what goes and where, that's really useful. And I remember for my first TMF job, I was going from clinical operations into like TMF. And I thought that they would like ask me like what document belongs where. And so I was like really like trying to like quiz myself on like what the artifact number is. That's E. And like Viva will use, which is the main eTMF system, will pretty much stick to this filing structure that is seen in here in the reference model. And so that's really useful. If you can kind of memorize the documents, then you'll have a better idea of where to file it, right? Now, I think Viva, last I checked, when you tried to upload a document, you had a drop-down menu. It just gave you the names, not the numbers. But then somewhere within like the kind of the back end has all the numbers in it. So these are all the different documents. KOM is the kickoff meeting. So that's a common term you'll see. Kind of anytime you get together to do something, you call it a kickoff meeting. So just to kind of help with that terminology. You have the trial management section. And then you have your central trial document. So this is more very like trial specific, like the actual trial documents, whereas management were like management documents, like our plans, right? So in two, we're looking central trial documents. We're looking more at like the protocol, the IB, which is the investigator brochure, any sort of updates to the IB, and then there's protocol synopsis. So just getting really familiar with the type of documents that you expect to see is really important. And then you have kind of items that would go out to the site. So a lot of times, your central trial document zone is items that sometimes are the ones that go out to the IRB, right? So you have your subject documentation, like the subject diary and questionnaires. You have your ICF items. Those are really important, and those go to the IRB to get approved because they're patient facing. Do you know what? Tell me what you know, Max, about an ICF.
It's the informed consent form. It's to show that the patient wasn't coerced, or if they were bribed into participating in something that would show that this trial was skewed.
Exactly. So it's they're being informed of their rights. And one key thing in there that a lot of people don't know is in the ICF, the patient has the right to leave the study anytime. Now that kind of screws over the sponsor, right? Because they've put in money, they've paid for this patient to be at this site, they're starting to collect data, right? They're giving the medication, which costs them money. And then if the patient leaves, they don't really get any data out of it. And that kind of sucks. And so I think a lot of times patients think, oh, I can't leave, right? Because like it'll like hurt the company and it'll kind of hurt the trial and my data won't be useful. But they actually have the right to leave anytime. And that's something that's really important from like a governmental responsibility, like making sure that the people still have rights. So let's see if we can find an example. Okay. So one of the things that I, like a year or so ago, we worked a lot on informed consent forms. And so it's saying, like, if you're reviewing your own ICF and you're trying to make sure that the study has the right items, it's saying here as kind of the tips is to make sure that the correct protocol number and the correct version is in here. And one reason for that is because if you work at a company that has, let's say, six different studies, the template for the ICF will look the same, right? They're probably going to stick to their own template. And maybe even I work on some studies where the molecule is like the drug is the same, right? They're just trying it in different indications or something. So you want to make sure that there's not an error where somebody uploaded a document, but they put it at the wrong study, which is possible, right? And so you don't want to be something where, because the ICF is one of the, like I said, one of the most important things. And so when you're coming in for the FDA to give an audit or an inspection, you want to see, like, let's say you have six versions, right? Because if anything goes wrong in the study, you need to update your ICF with, like, here's the informed consent. And then usually it's like, why? And then usually they list out benefits, but then they also list out, let's see, they usually list out the issues contact. Let's see, signature page. Okay, usually a lot of times they'll list out the risks for the study. If you join the study, you might lose your hair, or like the random things that we've seen that could happen. Hey, here we go, risks. But yeah, so they kind of talks a little bit about like what are the risks for the study, right? And so if as the study is happening and you notice, the doctor notices more and more people are losing their hair, then you need to update the IB so that the doctors know, and you need to update the ICF so the patients know. So that's why you'll have a lot of versions. And then a lot of times within the each version, you have multiple versions of it, in for the sense of like if there's kids in the study, right? So the kids have one, and the adults have a different one, right? So the main thing, look for the protocol number, But again, just getting yourself familiar with the different types of documents. So that's a good zone two document is the consent form. All right, so it's interesting. So the CSR actually also lives in zone two too. So I guess it's reports, the biological analytical report and the clinical study report. And the CSR is a document. Let's see if we have one. I'm not too sure we do. The CSR is like the final study summary, basically, right? It's how the study went. And let's see. And so you always have the history, but it's got like all the different documents and all the different things that happen. In terms of like, yeah, so you have like protocol deviations, discontinued subjects. And so these summary documents are a really good way to like learn about a study. And it's what's usually submitted at the end. So, and it's really big. So this is just a sample. It doesn't go into, so usually it's huge, right? You see it's 344 pages, right? So again, on, if you're QCing a document like this, you have to check out what your company's standards require you to do, because you might not need to look at every single page, right? Because it's 300 and whatever pages. So a lot of times you just check like the beginning, you might check like almost like quality check a couple pages, and you scan like, does page 50 say page 50, or does it say 49? Because then maybe there's one off somewhere, right? So you want to make sure that like, okay, like how many pages are there total? Does it seem complete? That's most companies will do. Because it's on the person who uploaded it to actually have, like, they are supposed to do a check, right? So the overall thing is they own the document. They're supposed to check their document that's complete. And then they upload the document into the system. And then somebody from TMF looks at the document to, like, do another check and make sure that it's uploaded to the right study, right zone, and that kind of thing. And there's no missing signatures, things like that. So that makes it nice because that means that realistically, you are a second set of eyes. So a lot of things should have already been caught. All right, so that was our zone two. Zone three is our regulatory. So these are the different submissions. And a lot of times you have a submission and then you want to have like a copy of like the approval of the submission. And then there's like conditional approval. The different things get filed different places, public registration. So, and regulatory is usually its own department. So we're hoping to have Mandy talk to us about some example, like what she does for her job in regulatory. A lot of times I think of regulatory as being really actively engaged in the beginning of the study to file, saying, hey, we want to do this FDA. And at the end, saying, hey, we're done. Come look at us. We should be good.
Okay. That's like the first checkpoint, so to speak.
And usually there's something called, let's see if it's in here. Let me see. So one thing that's nice about this document is you can control find. Let's see. There's a green. There's something that a lot of companies have called green light package. And so usually it's like to activate a site. So you gather all the site documents. And this is almost more of a CTA task, but it is heavily involving TMF documents. So it's good to know, but you gather all the site documents and then you put it all together into like a packet that you then submit to regulatory and they review it. And then they say, okay, yes, you can have this study or this site. Okay. So four is IRB. And so you have IRB submission, decision, kind of the list of who's on there. One thing to note is that sometimes they want the IRB, like the list of people who are on the IRB. But you need to make sure it's an actual document that has the list versus sometimes like a web page that has like a link to the list, because the list will change each year, right? So you need to download like list each year. That's something that's not going to be changing, because you know, you when you are being reviewed, it's usually like a year or two later, right? Okay, so 4 is IRB. Okay, 5 is a lot of the meat and the potatoes for the TMF and clinical operations. So that's why I think I have a soft spot for zone 5. So this is site management. These are everything that goes on to managing the study at this each site level. So you can think of the TMF as a filing folder, and maybe your drawers are the zones. And before, the artifact number is your files, right? But when you get to zone 5, it's almost like your cabinet is 5. And your drawer is going to be this section, the artifact. Because within there, you're going to have folders for each site usually. So zone 5 gets huge in that sense. Because let's see if we find something that. Okay, so it's not huge, but the protocol signature page, right? You need this, and so the protocol, remember we saw it, I think it belongs in zone 1. But in zone 5, you have all the ones that actually get signed. So follow me. I had a cough earlier, and it's like not going away, so hold on.
The zone 5 was like the one that is on the trial, the practice test the most, too.
Yep, exactly. And then the zone 5 is what you're, like, be very familiar with. Hold on, I'll come a few more times. Okay. So, a protocol signature page is an interesting one because sometimes people see it. And let's see if we can pull it up. But somebody might think, oh, this is wrong. This should be filed in zone 1. Or this is page, it says page 3, like, where's the rest of, so it might say page 3 out of 400, right? Because the protocol has 400 pages. So sometimes people go, oh, this doesn't fit the rules usually. There's one copy in the protocol, and then the sites are given this blank copy, basically. And then they need to have the investigator sign it and send it back. So yeah, signature, date, protocol number should always be making sure that's double checked, right? As we talked about, people can upload it to the wrong one.
Wait, so this one is allowed as just one?
Yes, exactly. So this is an exception to the rule. This is allowed as just one. And same thing with, so any signature page that is from an existing document. So the IB also has that. The investigators for sure should have it, and the protocol should have it. And then each time something's updated, they have to do a new one. The idea is that they're aware there's a new update, right? So ideally, they wouldn't sign it without knowing, wait, why are we having a new one? And that this is just helping trigger to make sure that they're aware of what's going on. And the overall goal is, to show sponsor oversight. Sponsor, the company that has the medication and sometimes has the TMF, is aware of what's going on, but they're making sure that everybody else is aware, which is a trickier aspect, right? So they're responsible for making sure people are informed, and sometimes it's hard because people might just show up to things. Part of what I do for my job is I have training that we do, and there's a virtual version, but we found out the people who do it virtually are not really as good as the people who do it. The people who can do it like online on their own, like a learning platform, or people who have to actually show up to a webinar and like listen. Because then we have a part 2 where they actually show them how to do the surgery. And a lot of times people are like, wait, what am I doing? And it's like, oh, because you didn't do the right, you weren't really paying attention during the part 1 training, right? So it is hard to make sure that as a sponsor that everyone's actually really informed. And so there's a lot of different things that we do to try to do that, right? So when you kick off a site, you try to go to the site and present to them saying, here's what the study's all about, so that even though they've had the protocol, again, it's like 300 page document, did they read all the pages? Do they fully understand it? Zone 5 has basically all of the items for the site. site selection setup. The sub I 1572 should be in here too. Yep, here we go. And then in general, the 1572 is one of the few documents that you will always look the same. You can add to it, right? It can be longer. But in general, all these documents, we're just showing you sample documents. When you start at a company and you're doing and filing their documents, each document, almost all these documents are going to look different. These are just examples, right? The 1572 is one of the few ones where it should look exactly the same because it's a standardized form from the government if you're running a U.S. track. Everything else will look a little bit different. So the 1572 is a very known document. And it's a good, just so you know, Max, get ready for interviews. A great question is, what do you know about the 1572? What is it used for? And what's on there? How well do you think you know your 1572?
Not very well. I would have to look at one.
Okay, good. So when you're done, go look at one. That's one of my go-to standard questions I ask people. If you are new, starting in TMF, you might be familiar with how to QC documents, but a good test of do you actually know your documents is the 1572. But we'll do interview prep next week. So you're zone five. I'll quickly go through the other ones because I think we're running out of time here. Site management, like I said, it's really large, and within each item, there should be a folder for each site, right? So like it can be huge. All right, so the next one is IP. Do you know what IP stands for, Max?
No.
Okay. Investigational product. So it means like the drug, the study drug. So it's what the product that they are investigating through the study. So there's a whole bunch of plans and instructions and usually shipping documentation. The shipping documentation, so 060104, is a large portion of what you'd see. All the other ones you'll see like a document or two, right? It's a plan or it's a sample label, but this one you're gonna have lots of acknowledgments of receipts, lots of temperature logs. So again, it's like almost like every time a batch of drug went out to the site, right? Per all the sites. So if you're, you know, if each site has, you know, receives 10 different batches and there's 50 sites, you're going to have 500 like sets of stuff. So that's a lot of the TMF work is in this folder. All right, and then everything else is kind of similar. The other one is the certificate of destruction, right? So drug went out to the site. If it either expires or the site's closed, the site has no more patients or whatnot, you need to destroy the drug, and you have to like show like how you destroyed it. And then there's also usually you have to collect their SOP on how they destroy the drug, right? So each university, each hospital might have its own process about how they dispose the drug, and we'll follow their process as long as it meets our standards. So talking about that green light package, sometimes that's something that gets pulled early in the study so that we know how a site is going to destroy the drug. Okay, so that's six. There's a couple other similar things. Unblinding plan. We can talk about blinding and unblinding later too. All right, seven is safety. Now, a lot of times there is an external safety database. So a lot of times, if there is one, then a lot of the documents might live there. But something like the plan should live here. So you have SAE reports. And we can go over, I think I've gone over that in a previous video. Just different reports, and this all has to do with safety. Relevant communications in this one is pretty important. Same thing with zone five. So each zone usually has communications, tracking, meeting minutes, as kind of like each zone has it, like a template. So you can file meetings that are related to IP in the IP zone and meetings that are related to safety in the safety zone, right? It's kind of like a very template folder. But for relevant communications, it's really critical for safety because you want to capture important decisions. And a lot of times important decisions are critical for safety in the sense of, did a study doctor from the site message the medical monitor, who's from the sponsor, and say, hey, my patient has this. Do you think that's weird? How do you think we should treat it? Or like, what's going on? Now, a lot of times the rule is the doctor on the site, it's their patient, and they can do whatever they want if it's for the safety of their patient. But a lot of times if they do things, it might make it so that they no longer, the patient can't be in the study anymore. So a lot of times they will confer with the medical monitor. The medical monitor shouldn't make the decision in a sense. If it is one of those things where it's related to the safety of the patient. But sometimes it's like, hey, my patient is having this, is that an issue? And sometimes, again, unfortunately, part of what the whole process of the TMF is to prove that everyone is honest in a sense. And so safety relevant communications is where sometimes like the FDA can snoop to see if anything was fishy. Like, was there an email from one doctor saying, hey, my patient's having this, what do you think we should do? And the doctor said, oh, you should do this. And then maybe the patient died, you know, like, and then maybe that got covered up or something less serious. It could be something similar, but where the patient's like, hey, they're having this sickness. And you usually don't want to report that many sicknesses, right? You don't want any side effects, right? When you buy a drug on that label, it'll say, here are the different side effects, you know, it might cause dizziness and drowsy or something. You don't really want to. You want to have as little as possible that helps sell your drug, right? But you can't cover it up. And so that's part of what the FDA is making sure. Was anything covered up? Was there actually signs of something going wrong and you didn't report it? And tracking and asking the FDA, asking, hey, can we have all your emails about this? Is a good way for the FDA to have kind of a backup plan to make sure that you actually did report all your safety items, right?
So that's like a sorted chat. Essentially.
Yeah, exactly. And that people usually have on the company, the sponsor side, they're kind of confused for what should we put in the relevant communications. And it should be any sort of decision made. It shouldn't be how, oh, hi, Sally, how was your vacation? And then they talk about the vacation. Like that doesn't need to get filed, right? Some people will just take their entire email box and like throw it in there, which you can do. There's like ways to upload it. You don't really want to do that. You want to just do like decisions that are made. And that's one way to check, because I'm getting ready to do some TMF work to clean up our studies. And that's something to check because that's something that some people forget to put in there. Because it's not a document that you're like, oh, I have a document, I'm going to file it in the TMF. You have like an email and a decision was made. Did you remember to like download it and put it in your TMF? Like pretty low likelihood. So in my days in clinical operations, I would like flag items that were decision making that I would want to put in there. But it's important, and relevant communications for safety is really important here. All right, and then we go from, so 7 is safety, 8 is central testing. This is where you're gonna have your lab documentations. One question that I could ask Max for an interview question would be, what is your CLIA and what is your CAPA? And people might not be like, oh, I don't know. So they're your lab certifications. So those are important. So each site should have a valid CLIA and CAPA. You also need the lab director CV and some other items, but those are kind of good buzzwords to know for an interview. And again, it's not really required for the job to know every single document, but it really helps. Like it really, and like when you start the job, you want to kill it. Any job you start, you want to just really impress people and come out of the gates. And so to do that, you want to have a really solid understanding. So like knowing this document, like you said, if you print it and you read through it, as boring as that sounds, it's actually super useful. And like I said, I super nerdily like one time studied it to the point where I could like, you know, tell you the different names and stuff like that. And then I did the interview and no one asked me, but I remember being like kind of disappointed. I was like, wait, I can like cite where everything is. Because I was going from a clinical operations to TMF, so I didn't know how much you needed for TMF. But okay, eight is your, you were talking about the labs, documentation, shipping records. Now it's interesting here because we already have the IP, right? So I haven't really ever seen stuff in this folder, but it might mean something else that's being shipped, non IP related. Do we have any? Let's see what's in here. Shipment record. Let's see. Okay, this is the shipping inventory log. Okay, so it's kind of like when they got what shipments for which site. Okay. Yeah, so it's like a big shipment log of one went over. So interesting that that is in zone 8, not zone, what did we say, 6 was IP? Yeah, 6 IP. Okay, and then 9 is third party. I, for my current job, work a lot in third party. Most of my team are filing in third party because I'm managing the vendors that help run the studies, and I do more like tech stuff for it. So I'm constantly uploading my stuff into this one. Just my meeting minutes for my vendors in the third party folder. So a lot of the different plans and things like that, communication plans, things you have, but for each vendor is in your third party, so zone 9. Zone 10 is data management. And again, you don't want, the idea is that there's an external database. We're all like a, usually called EDC, is where all the patient data goes into. That doesn't belong in the TMF. But what does belong in the TMF is like kind of like the rules of like what, how was that system set up? How is it validated? Like they have like a coding dictionary. How are they going to do their SAE reconciliation? The kind of like the rules for things, the database lock and unlock approvals, that goes into zone 10, which is data management.